Hello, this is Pastor Malin Smith, pastor here at New Hope Baptist Church here in Watertown, New York, and I welcome you to our ongoing video series, Journeying Through the Books of the Bible, where today we're going to be talking about the book of Acts. And if we were to summarize or to identify the purpose of the book of Acts in the New Testament, we could classify it as being a sequel to The Greatest Life. Now, why do I say that? Well, it's because Acts functions as volume 2 of a 2-volume work. That is to say, it is volume 2 and the Gospel of Luke is volume 1. Both Luke and Acts were written by the same author, namely Luke the physician. Now, Luke was a companion of the Apostle Paul. And Acts chapter 1, verse 1 begins this way. The first account I composed, Theophilus, about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after he had by the Holy Spirit given orders to the apostles whom he had chosen. So what Luke is doing there in Acts 1:1-2, he is reminding Theophilus, to whom he had written the book of Acts, he's reminding him of his first volume, namely the Gospel of Luke. And some believe that both may very well have been bound into one volume, and then at somewhere along the line, they were divided into two separate works. But the book of Acts is all about the Acts of the Apostles. Matter of fact, that is traditionally its historical name, Acts of the Apostles. And the reason it's called that is because in the book of Acts, we see two main apostles featured. In the first 12 chapters, the primary area focuses on the Apostle Peter. And then in chapters 13-28, we see focus being shifted to Saul of Tarsus, who was otherwise known as the Apostle Paul. And so the book of Acts is known as Acts of the Apostles. Others have also noted that since the book of Acts records for us the coming of the Holy Spirit, some have suggested also that it is the Acts of the Holy Spirit, because after all, the Holy Spirit is working through the apostles and their preaching. And what we see here in the book of Acts is the birth of the early church. We see what would gradually be the westward expansion of Christianity from Jerusalem all the way across the Mediterranean world. And I have up here today a map. And this map depicts for you what would be the main setting of the book of Acts. Now, we have here the Mediterranean Sea. So this represents roughly 2,000 miles of area. Down here we have Jerusalem, the land of Israel. So we have Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and then we have the remainder of what was then the Roman world back in the first century. And Acts 1:8 actually gives us what we could say is an outline of the book of Acts. Acts 1:8 says this. This is Jesus speaking. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and even to the remotest part of the earth. So if you look up here on our map, you'll notice here I have three main circles. The first circle records for us what Jesus told his apostles, namely, that they were first to have their ministry in Jerusalem and Judea. And that covers Acts chapters 1-8. That's where we see the early church having its beginnings. The Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost, and then the early church, being predominated by Jews, had its beginnings in Jerusalem. So really, the first church was in Jerusalem, and that was the mother church. And so that's where we see the beginnings of the Christian movement. And then in chapters 9-12, we see the early church begin to expand into the north to Samaria. And so that follows in lines with what we read there in Acts 1:8, namely where Jesus says, "And you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria." So chapters 9-12 feature for us the ministry of the Apostle Peter and how gradually the early church began to become more and more Gentile in its orientation. And so by the time we get to the end of chapter 12 of the book of Acts, now we're seeing more and more Gentiles come to faith. Then, as Saul of Tarsus would be encountered by the post-resurrected Christ on the road to Damascus, he being originally a persecutor of the church, as he was encountered by Christ in Acts chapter 9, we see Saul being called by the Lord to be an apostle to the nations or the Gentiles. And so in Acts chapter 13, that's where we see Paul and Barnabas being commissioned by the church to go into all the uttermost parts of the earth. And so in chapter 13, we see the center of Christianity switch from Jerusalem to Antioch. And so as you go through chapters 13 all the way to 28, that's where you see Paul doing a series of what we call missionary journeys. And as he goes, the Christian movement shifts from being pushed northward more to the westward part of the Roman Empire. And Paul, as you read throughout the rest of his letters that he would write in the New Testament, he talked about how he wanted to continue to preach the gospel where it had never been preached before. So the book of Acts is valuable because it provides a historical backdrop for the New Testament letters. Now, in terms of what we mentioned earlier, how the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts comprise Volume 1 and Volume 2, of course, the Gospel of Luke focuses our attention upon the life, ministry, death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then the book of Acts tells us, well, what happened following Christ's ascension? So when we look at the book of Luke and the book of Acts, they constitute what we could call a core of our New Testament. Not only that, but both Luke and Acts are the largest books or the longest books in our New Testaments. Together, they occupy 27% of the total word count in the New Testament. So Luke and Acts together occupy a significant portion in our New Testaments. Now, when it comes to some of the major truths that are taught in the book of Acts, we can note eight of them. The Holy Spirit is undoubtedly the key person in the book of Acts. His coming on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, as well as his subsequent outpourings in chapters 8, 10, and 19. Missions is also figured prominently in the book of Acts. After all, we see the westward expansion of the early church as the church began at Jerusalem, and then Judea and Samaria, and then the uttermost parts of the earth. Particularly under the ministry of the Apostle Paul. We see the early church spreading throughout the Mediterranean world. We also see the theme of suffering. And many people may not realize this, but the early church spread as a result of suffering and persecution. A lot of people think that if we didn't have to suffer, maybe we would do better as Christians. However, contrary to that popular belief, when you read the book of Acts, only when the church was pressured and persecuted, only then did she spread. Salvation is also a major theme in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 4, verse 12, for example, tells us that no other name is given under heaven among men whereby we must be saved. And of course, that name being Jesus Christ. Acts 16, 31 tells us what we must do to be saved. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. The Lord Jesus Christ is figured prominently in the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 1, we see reference to his ascension into heaven. And in chapter 9, we see him encounter Saul of Tarsus on the road to Damascus. Preaching is also found in the book of Acts. Whenever you read throughout the book of Acts, you'll see roughly 20 sermons preached by Peter and Paul and others, and the half of them center upon the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Of course, church life is also a major theme in the book of Acts. We see the early church in Jerusalem, and then later on, especially as we go throughout the Mediterranean world, and that's one reason why the book of Acts is so valuable to study, because it gives us the historical background to what will later be Paul's letters. And we can also read Paul's letters in line with some of the major chapters of the book of Acts. Then, of course, the key figures of the book of Acts are the apostles Peter and Paul. And so those are some of the teachings that we find in the book of Acts. There's so much more that we could say about this important book of the Bible. But all I can tell you is this. that it is the sequel to The Greatest Life. And what the book of Acts represents is how the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ would continue on through the person and the work of the Holy Spirit working through His church. As the church proclaims the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, all that He achieved, all that He accomplished, and how for anyone who by grace through faith trusts in Christ, how they can be part of this worldwide movement known as Christianity. And so this is Pastor Malin Smith of New Hope Baptist Church here in Watertown, New York. I'm so thankful that you took the time today to watch this video, and may God richly bless you.